It is a pleasure to introduce our first panel, the World Wide Web, as we start to understand different views on how we balance liberty, security, privacy. So with us we have Julie Brill, Martin Eifert, Jeanette Hofmann, Ronaldo Lemos, Joel Reidenberg, and moderating Matthias Mueller von Blumenkron. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for that short and quick introduction. We have the honor to be the opening panel of this wonderful conference, and we have assembled a great podium, specialists from three different nations, from three continents, but they all share a common passion, passion for the digital world, passion for the future, passion for politics, and also for legal affairs. We want to talk about the differences in different parts of the world when it comes to our views of the digital revolution and where we can perhaps find common ground. Let's just jump into our debate. The discussion about the internet is often so fragmented that we, even ourselves, we lose track what are our main issues. And for this reason, I would like to start and ask everybody what bothers you the most when you look at the digital revolution, when it comes in respect or when we risk liberty and privacy, and what gives you hope. Julie, would you like to start with
that? I'd be thrilled to start, but first I want to thank Princeton and the Fung Forum for inviting me here to speak. It's really an honor. When I was a Federal Trade Commissioner, I was very focused on Europe and European privacy issues, and I spent a great deal of time explaining U.S. privacy law and U.S. privacy policy and cybersecurity policy to Europeans and especially Germans, and then also translating European concerns and issues to the United States policymakers and others and companies and whatnot. So it's wonderful to be back here. I think this is about my 20th trip to Berlin in the past 5 years. So what do I worry about the most? I'd also like to say, what am I most hopeful about? I would say, in 1 minute, I think I'm worried the most about whether or not the ecosystem of the digital economy will effectively create and maintain trust so that consumers, individuals, governments, and other stakeholders will feel comfortable using the incredible tools that are going to be coming online that will do so much to improve lives, and yet everyone will feel comfortable that they're not being treated unfairly, they're not being discriminated against, and there are appropriate frameworks to ensure that that will be the case. So at a very high level, that's my biggest concern, and my biggest hope is that we can create that and maintain that kind of trust.
Martin, would you like to continue?
I'll just subscribe to your thank you to Princeton and come straight to the point. My main concern is how to bring public accountability to technological development. I think algorithms should be sensitive to private rights such as privacy, and they should be sensitive to public good. And the question is, how can we achieve it? And the question is crucial because the internet has become pervasive. It's shaping our everyday life. It's shaping the way we are doing business, the way we are doing politics, science, and so forth. And as it is so pervasive, it should be subject of political debate. And the question is, how can we manage to do that? And what makes me hopeful, maybe, may I just add this one,
course.
Because I think it's a nice point, is that we are starting a very discussion upon these issues. And we can observe that in many countries, similar discussions are going on. And moreover, they're even connected to each other. And therefore, I think it's sort of a nice paradox that talking about the problems of the current state of the internet is just helps bringing the promise to us, this kind of global sphere of communication.
Jeanette.
Yeah, I've been thinking hard about how to put my point in a non-biased way, and this is what I came up with.
You can do it biased.
my greatest concern right now is the tight coupling between collecting, storing, and analyzing personal data and the current business models, the development of new services, the quality of new services, but also strategies by public agencies to prevent crime, to prevent terror, and more generally, to produce security. This tight coupling, I think, produces major problems and more problems than we are at the moment care to anticipate. So we will have many side effects that might actually increase the uncertainty that we feel right now and that make us do all these things with personal data. So I think we need to tackle this problem. And my great hope is that we use digital devices to redefine of what we mean by individual, but also collective self-determination.
Ronaldo.
All right, well, first, thanks to Princeton to be here. For me, it feels almost like a class reunion, seeing so many colleagues from CITP, and it's really great to be here. So the first thing that gets me worried, it's a little bit the concentration of resources, especially at the infrastructure level regarding the internet. So when Vint Cerf showed his map of how the internet is a distributed network, and when you think how it's organized now in terms of the infrastructure or the servers, I think there's a lot of concentration going on. And I worry about both the private sector and also the government being able to exercise control about this. So one example is the fact that WhatsApp, the service, has been shut down in Brazil 3 times. Brazil, just to remember, is a democratic country. And in spite of that, the courts were able to issue an order to shut down an entire service with 100 million users in Brazil, and that was affected actually in 1 day. So that makes me worried about the resilience of the network and the capability actually to intervene over it. What makes me excited about the internet right now is actually how technology can actually be used for civic purposes. So I think we are in a crisis regarding trust and democracy. And at least the way I see it, especially from my perspective in Latin America, is that Brazil and a few other countries there have become somehow a laboratory for civic participation using the internet. And that makes me excited, and especially using technologies like the blockchain, which is a trust-enabling technology. And I believe the blockchain is a sandbox for institutional imagination. I think it's going to have a deep impact if well used to promote the public interest.
And you, Joe.
Thank you. Delighted to be here this morning for the session. My biggest worry is that the mechanisms we have in democracies are not currently capable of effectively assuring civil liberties and public accountability in the online world. The positive spin to that, the aspect that gives me hope, is that I think we're in a period now where we can think about and re-engineer our governance mechanisms in ways that going forward, we can respond more effectively for civil liberties and accountability.
Thank you very much. Very interesting topics. I would like to just jump into one thing, one concrete measure where we can, along that, we can debate most of those issues, actually. Our Secretary of Justice is these days announcing a new law which would force Facebook to remove illegal content within 24 hours and otherwise have to pay big penalties. But it also has to remove within 7 days content which is not so obviously illegal, which is illegal but not so obviously. Jeanette, what do you think? What do we put on the shoulders of the platforms? Is it good to put those decisions in the hand of such an entity?
I can understand why the German government feels under pressure to act. But like many people who have now commented on this draft law, I see a lot of shortcomings and also dangers implied in that draft law. One of them is that we sort of delegate to the private sector to decide what is legal and what is illegal. That reminds us a bit of the European Court ruling on the right to be forgotten, same thing. While I think it's a good idea to proceduralize many of the new problems and conflicts we are dealing with right now, I'm not sure we want to sort of increase our problem of accountability by delegating such important decisions to be done within hours or days to the private sector. One of the issues we will create is make the private sector to sort of take down content just to prevent fines.
Martin, I would like to hear a little bit more of the German side and how you think about that. Politicians, some leading green politicians even want that Facebook takes off content which is not legal, but discriminatory.
Well, I think
so
that's,
where do that, we go there?
That's a very point, because I mean, the question is, do we really increase significantly the power of the intermediaries if we ask them to delete or to remove this content? And I think they have the power anyway. Therefore, to a certain extent, it's inevitable. The only question is whether or not we make them accountable. And therefore, I would even go a step further, and I would ask them to publish their decisions and their statements of the grounds. Of course, the public cannot scrutinize this vast number of decisions, but there will be actors in civil society that will evaluate it, that will monitor it, that will ask for biases, and that makes it subject of political discourse, and then we can talk about it and we make it accountable to the public. Therefore, I think it's inevitable that at a first step they are responsible for removing it or not removing it. It's the same with the newspaper or with every other media, and we can make them accountable by publishing the decisions.
Joel, how does it sound from an American perspective?
We already do this in the United States for intellectual property. We have a system called notice and takedown. If an intellectual property rights holder feels that their copyright is being violated by the posting of content, they can complain to the hosting service, and the hosting service has to take it down. There's a mechanism, what I don't know if the proposal in German law has a mechanism to contest the decision of the hosting service. So in cases where it's disputable that the content is illegal, it really shouldn't be the private company that is the ultimate arbiter of the legality of that content. I think there needs to be a proper legal mechanism to determine whether or not it truly is illegal content. And if it is legal content, then there needs to be a mechanism to enable it to be reposted.
Intellectual property is a different cause than when it comes to areas where we touch the right of free speech. Julie, how do you see that?
So there's a lot to this issue, and I'd like to break it down in a couple of different ways. So first of all, there's a feeling in Europe, and particularly in Germany, that the United States does not have a right of erasure or any kind of right to be forgotten, or for that matter, that there have been no efforts on the part of US law enforcement to ensure that platforms don't publish illegal content. Leaving aside what Joel pointed out, which is absolutely true, but that tends to be sort of a private arbitration in terms of the intellectual property issue, there actually have been efforts in the United States to deal with this issue. So the state attorneys general, who deal a lot with privacy and cybersecurity issues at a local level, have long engaged with Facebook and with other platforms to talk about child pornography and to help deal with the very deep concern about exploitation of children and taking down images that are clearly exploitative of children. This has been an initiative that has been underway probably for about 10 to 15 years. There's also been some effort on the part of the state attorneys general to focus on illegal advertising on Google in terms of pharmaceutical ads and other things like that. So to say that the United States isn't focusing in on what the platforms are doing just really wouldn't be true. I do agree that it is sort of ironic that the systems that are being set up, whether through the German law or whether through the Right to Be Forgotten decision, the Consteja decision from the European Court of Justice, place a tremendous amount of authority in the hands of companies. And as to your point with respect to wanting to see more accountability with respect to these decisions, actually the interpretation of European data protection authorities is that companies can't publicize when they take down information through the Right to Be Forgotten. Because if you do that, then you're letting people know that there was something there to be forgotten. I mean, the whole thing is incredibly ironic, but it does. That's the ruling. That's the way that they have interpreted it. No, I agree with you. I would actually like to see more accountability with respect to these decisions, and I think the companies would like to be able to say, we have taken down content because someone asked for this content to be taken down, but they can't. But I think that there's a deeper conversation to be had here with respect to the perspective in the United States on some of these issues, and I'd like to particularly focus on this issue of the right of erasure, or the right to be forgotten. And this is another meme that, does this exist in the United States or doesn't it? It actually does exist, and it has existed for a long time. It's much more narrow. In the United States, when there is information that is used with respect to employment, insurance, credit or housing, and that information is 7 years old, or in some cases 10 years old or older, it needs to disappear. It can't be used. It's deemed to be too old for the purposes of making decisions about those significant issues in consumers' lives. Most Europeans know nothing about this, but it's actually been in existence for about 40 years. So this notion that there is no right of erasure in the United States just isn't true. It is admittedly much, much more narrow. But my view is, and I think that many people in the United States feel, that eliminating information about someone's past through that's publicized in newspapers or whatnot is really not what is at the heart of the issue behind the right to be forgotten or the right of erasure. In my view, the reason why this is so important in Europe is because there's much less forgiveness in German society and in other societies when people make mistakes. You make a mistake, you've been in bankruptcy, you failed to pay a debt, that's it, you're done. Whereas in the United States, actually, first of all, if you go through bankruptcy, you're actually then considered a better risk. Creditors will actually loan you because you can't go into bankruptcy again for another 7 years. And frankly, going into bankruptcy, it's true. And going into bankruptcy is actually sort of a badge of honor in terms of, entrepreneurial ethos. You've made a mistake, you've learned, now you're going to do much better. So this notion of forgiveness, I think, is what's at the heart of the right to be forgotten. And I think taking down speech because you don't have the ability to forgive people is not the right way to deal with it. I think people should know if you've committed a crime. If you were a child molester, people should know that. But if you've, if you've gone into bankruptcy or you failed to pay a debt, maybe we should just be thinking about that differently in Europe.
Jeanette, it seems that you disagree. I find it an interesting point. Of course, our laws are reflections of our cultures.
Yes.
And so the question is, can we even come? When, for example, we go to the right to be forgotten, can we even come to a conclusion between the US and the EU?
Actually, I wanted to comment on something else, and that was on Martin's point about just publish the decisions made by the platform, and that solves the issue. And the example that comes to mind is Facebook's controversial decision last summer to take down this anti-Vietnam War picture. Mm-hmm. As we know, this had been taken down many times before, always on the grounds of this is child nudity and therefore forbidden and doesn't follow our own rules. It took a Norwegian newspaper, it took the intervention of a Norwegian president to actually fight that decision and change that rule. And do all the people whose content might be taken down for wrong reasons have that kind of power to actually counteract on decisions made most of the times by algorithms of major platforms? I'm not so sure. So I do see your point. Many lawyers tend to do that. Transparency as the remedy for power imbalances. But I think in this case, we have a more complex problem to deal with, and that is freedom of speech, which often conflicts with other human rights principles, and how we deal with these conflicts of fundamental principles. I'm not so sure how to sort of address this.
Ronaldo, you were part of the authors of the Brazilian Charter of the Internet, which got in use like 3 years ago?
Yes, 2014. Yes.
Can we learn anything from your experience?
Yeah, well, the Brazilian Internet Bill of Rights was passed in 2014, and it took us basically 7 years of intensive discussions. So it was a bill that was built collaboratively. It was not drafted behind closed doors, but throughout a platform of multi-stakeholder participation. And it actually had a very interesting and positive view in my perspective. So it protects net neutrality, it protects privacy rights, at least the basics of it, and it protects free speech online. So when I see the discussions in Germany, it's important to mention that whatever happens in the US, Germany, Europe, it's very influential over other parts of the world. So Brazilian legislators, and especially Brazilian politicians, they are not happy with a free speech, open internet, especially because the internet has been used to say bad things about them. And of course, Brazil are involved, is right now like getting rid of corruption and overcoming corruption. So there are a lot of politicians being affected, and they are really not happy about that, you know. So they want to exercise some sort of control. And that worries me a lot. And I really think like establish some form of like notice and takedown for offensive content is really dangerous, because unlike copyright infringement, in which at least you have some grounds of objectivity, in which this is infringement or this is not, offensive content, something that is offensive to someone might not be offensive to another. And if you have like the intermediaries deciding as like what is offensive and should be taken down or not, I think this is a big privatization of justice. In my view, it's a threat to due process. So that worries me a lot. So if Germany moves that way, I can tell you that a lot of Brazilian politicians will be really happy, and they will want to follow your steps, you know.
But just to avoid any misunderstanding, we are not talking about offensive content. We are talking about illegal content, and illegality is defined by a certain criminal offenses, which makes a huge difference.
Yeah. But sometimes that's going to be a judgment call, whether it's illegal or not. And I think to some of the points that Jeanette and Julie were making, the question is really how would you build into that kind of system an accountability for the decisions to remove? In the case Julie was discussing about the bankruptcies that can't be reported after 7 or 10 years under our Fair Credit Reporting Act, that's an open and shut case. There's a bankruptcy proceeding, there's a bankruptcy decision, so we actually know specifically through a legal proceeding. There are various ways. I think Jeanette's point earlier that, you know, does an individual have the resources of the country's president to put pressure? Most people don't. But you can envision alternate third-party mechanisms that would be the arbiters of a decision made by the company. So that you could have an individual, if an individual disagrees, the poster disagrees that this is illegal content, that there be some kind of independent mechanism to judge whether the company was right or wrong in deeming it illegal content.
But is that practical? There are millions of postings every day on Facebook, and certainly many are not so friendly. The speech is probably sometimes borderlining information or even information?
I don't know. I mean, they already have a mechanism and an internal. My understanding is there's an internal group that vets complaints. I don't know empirically what percentage of the complaints they get are really these borderline cases. I mean, that's something, again, that goes back, I think, to what Ronaldo was saying, that you need to have a participatory process to figure out what could work, what would be an effective accountability mechanism for the decisions made about the legality or illegality of the content.
Well, can I just jump in on that point? Because there have been some scholars who have addressed these issues and have talked about using an analogous board from the medical context. So institutional review boards in the United States are deeply involved with vetting whether or not experiments are appropriate, are humane, satisfy all, ethical requirements. And so some people have thought to take that concept of an institutional review board that's used in the context of human trials, human medical trials, and put it in place where we're talking about these data issues. I actually think that that's an incredibly creative notion. And if you look at, just as one example, what Google has done with respect to right of erasure or right to be forgotten, it has established a board of people who are renowned civil rights experts, human dignity experts, ethicists, sociologists, and whatnot, to oversee this process. I don't know about the all I know is what's public, right? So I don't know about how the details of how this board works in minute or granular way. And I doubt that they have the ability to review every single decision. Because I think when you're a platform like Google or Facebook, literally every day there's probably hundreds of requests that are being filed. And so you have to have a team internally of hundreds of people to review this. Which actually leads me to a really interesting point. So I do think, though, to Joel's point, that we can set up accountability mechanisms and that there are some models to work with, as Ryan Kahlo has at Washington University has proposed. But when you think about the competitive effect, the effect of having to have a regime like this inside a company in order to deal with all the requests that come in, what does it do? It seems to me that what this policy will set up is a means so that only the biggest companies will really be able to comply, right? I mean, you are going to have a system that is going to require, it is not done, Jeanette, in all fairness, it is not done by algorithms. These decisions are made by humans. The decision to take down that Vietnamese, the very, very important historical photo, was made by humans, not by algorithms. It was challenged by humans, and then there was human review of whether or not it was appropriate to take it down. And ultimately, Facebook decided it needed to go up for historical, very important historical reasons. Will startups have the ability to do this? Will new entrants have the ability to do this? So I just urge, and I actually think that with respect to European policy, there is a lot of thought about the competitive landscape. There is a lot of thought about the economic implications of these policies. But when it comes to something like right to be forgotten or any kind of decision-making process where you're going to need a very strong internal mechanism to make these decisions, there are going to be competitive effects to that as well.
I think it is a very important point. We always talk about Facebook. Twitter, for example, is at the moment perhaps even a bigger problem, but it's also a financially struggling company. So Martin, how can we put your proposal in reality, in work, without stifling innovation?
May I just first come to that point of startups, because of course, otherwise we are freezing oligopolies, and that's what we do not want to do. But we can use thresholds. That's what's done by the drafted legislation
we
in Germany.
What?
Thresholds.
Yep.
So the field of application is limited to companies that have more than 2 million users in Germany.
Yeah, but that is a
and
huge mistake. Therefore, that's a terrible
mistake.
Well,
we can talk about
mistake.
How high the threshold should be. But nevertheless, it's one possibility to put the burden on those companies who really have a big effect on the public opinion.
In all fairness, I'm so sorry for interrupting you. I'm a New Yorker. We just always interrupt people. Forgive me. Let me just say really quickly, and like this is the two-finger interruption. The Federal Trade Commission has focused on enforcing privacy and cybersecurity for many, many years. And we, of course, the FTC does focus on, of course, the very biggest companies and has taken action against Facebook, Google, MySpace, Twitter, blah, blah, blah. But it is often the very smallest companies, the startups, that can have the most impact in a negative way on consumers, whether it's financial impact or whether it's this precise issue. So in my view, having that kind of threshold would actually allow a lot of bad behavior on the part of startups that could cause a lot of harm before you trigger the ability or the requirement to start taking down content.
Well, Julie, but
so
your
what are you doing?
Sorry, but your alternative is not having any regulation at all. And that, that would make even greater harm,
or,
I mean, of course.
Or being
and
more thoughtful about
it's
it.
It's just a trade-off between, between fostering startups and putting a burden on those that are presumably have the most effect.
I think
but nevertheless, I think you raised another point that's very interesting. When you were talking about this kind of publishing the decisions, it's not about the single case that will be up to discourse. It's about the criteria that are used.
Yes.
And that's what you were focusing on.
Correct.
Because,
I mean,
they're setting up a list of criteria. And this should be just subject of public discourse.
Yes.
And you can do that without without interfering with privacy once again. By the way, I think as far as the publication is concerned, we should differ between hate speech issues, which do not always raise the same privacy concern as it was raised by the infringement, and privacy issues. And nevertheless, as far as privacy issues are concerned, we can tell the story in a way that is not naming the person again, so that we can discuss the criteria that were driving the decisions without having any further infringement of privacy. And therefore, I think we could set up procedures and mechanisms that allow for public discussion and that enable politics just to think about regulations or not to think about them. And courts can look at them and they can decide whether or not this kind of convergence in the internet sphere is good and could be taken for local decisions.
Joel, what do you like, Dumbe?
Yeah, I was going to suggest to the point about whether or not this would harm the be a competitive problem or a crushing blow for startups. I don't buy that because I think there are a variety of ways. It doesn't have to be an internal review board. It can be an external mechanism that's set up, which would be equally available to the small company, to small companies as well as large companies. I mean, if we look, for example, in the intellectual property context, and that's an economic right. I think you were right to mention that when I was talking about. We have no problem doing notice and takedown for economic rights. The right to be forgotten cases that Google reports in its transparency report represent less than 1/10 the number of IP cases they deal with. So they can deal with 99, they can deal with all of these IP cases, and that's working smoothly. The civil rights cases, the right to be forgotten cases, are trivial compared to the economic rights cases they've dealt with. So I think in that sense, we need to be creative about the oversight mechanism.
Jeanette.
I'd like to object to that. Take, for example, the content ID system used by YouTube. We know it all started with the ruling saying you have to take down content within a certain time frame. Of course, companies are going to digitalize such a system because how will you otherwise deal with so much content uploaded on platforms? That is what constitutes platform, that people upload their stuff on a really high frequency. Now think of small startups like SoundCloud that was founded in Berlin, for example. If it becomes mandatory to use technical systems to take down content, how is a startup able to handle this? The content ID system is not something that is shared by many companies. It actually means
but
that established companies will have no competition by startups because startups will think twice before they go into a business where they know they need so much capital to comply with the law.
So you don't think a startup would emerge that would provide that as a service? I mean, you're assuming that the only organizations would, that organizations would have to do it in-house.
From what I understand, these systems are very specific to the very platform.
But that's at the moment. Why couldn't we have a scenario where we see technological innovations where service providers offer that as services to startup? We have in all sorts of
other Whether it's internal or external expense,
I'm not ruling this out. I'm just saying, I would say it's highly speculative whether that is actually a viable business model. We don't know that, but we can see right now that this kind of regulation has unintended side effects, and that is hindering competition.
We also have recent court decisions in the United States that bar the ultimate decision being purely technologically based. There's a court decision that imposes on the YouTubes and the other content providers. They have to vet before they take down. They have to recognize whether the content would be subject to a fair use claim. So it's a little more complicated. Now, whether machine learning in the future will reach a point where it can do that kind of analysis on an automated basis has yet to be seen.
Very interesting. So we all see what we have at the moment, and what gets passed in Germany at the moment is certainly not perfect. But the perfect solution is also not necessarily at the horizon. So we have still to work on it. We have to work on many different issues as well. I would like to come to another point. During the American election, both parties used basically all the newest tricks of digital direct marketing, especially highly targeted individual advertisement. Are these services endangering democracy? Germany has its elections in 6 months, so we are very much thinking about this as well.
Can I jump in?
Absolutely.
All right. So the fresh news of yesterday in Brazil is that Cambridge Analytica is going to open an office in the country. So if you're not familiar with Cambridge Analytica, it's a company that joins big data with psychometrics. And basically, by analyzing your behavior online, they classify you as among certain predefined types of personality. And basically, that allows you to receive political content customized by your certain personality. So if you suffer from neuroticism, you will get a lot of fear-mongering advertisement and something that makes you more fearful. So apparently, at least they say, it works. And that worries me a little bit, especially in the context of Brazil, because we have presidential elections next year as well. And I think this is a challenge that we will have to deal collectively. So a lot of the discussion is going about the fake news problem. And I think there are two points that have to be considered here. One is that fake news often is a problem of missing information and not only disinformation. So the problem is you don't know the authorship of what you're reading. You don't know where it comes from. You don't know who paid for that. You don't know if that is an individual that is posting or a company. So I wonder if we are able to create better tools to actually increase the information that we get about the stuff that we read online. So that's the first point. The second point, I see a lot of discussions framing this issue regarding the platform, so Google, Facebook, Twitter, whatever. But actually, what I see emerging is actually an industry of the fake news. So if you go a little deeper, the process of disseminating fake news is actually supported by tracking individuals using like beacons and JavaScript embedded in like millions of websites that basically track your behavior. And there is people actually making a lot of money out of this. They either make money out of this because they attract traffic, and so they get paid by internet advertising, or because they do consulting like Cambridge Analytica, and they maintain these tracking networks and get really well paid by wannabe politicians and so on to get their campaigns organized. So I wonder if we should not think of a way of going after, or at least making it clear that there is a fake news industry, a manipulation industry among us, and actually think we have what we have to do about that.
Jeanette, would direct marketing and political campaigns increase the fake news problems as Ronaldo described it?
I would go one step back and just talk about this topic of micro-targeting. I did a bit of literature research on this and found that as long as the Democratic Party in the US used micro-targeting in 2008 and 2012, the reporting was actually very positive about how the Obama campaign benefited from these new tools and were able to spend their campaigning funding in a more effective way, et cetera, et cetera. And the reporting changed completely when during the last election campaign in the US, and we see suddenly that companies who were depicted in a more positive light in the campaigns before are now become sort of horror companies who manipulate us.
Because they worked for President T.
Yeah, because the wrong party benefited from it. So I think we need to be careful here to and do more empirical research, because so far it is absolutely inconclusive what kind of effects these new tools actually have on voters' behavior. We don't know that. We just assume that it does have effects. And I would also caution, because voters are not stupid, they will learn. If they are sort of tormented by people calling them five times a day, they will just stop listening. So I would assume that these kind of tools that may have had an effect on this or last year's campaigns may not have the same effects on the coming elections.
Martin, how do you see that?
I think whether or not they can learn depends on how subtle the mechanism is used, and therefore I would not totally rely on that. I think what's disturbing for us, what raises our concerns, is that it goes back to the question, what do you think about elections? Is it just an aggregation of individual preferences? In that case, probably just micro-targeting is a mechanism of marketing and can be used as it is in the economic sphere. And we had this question in the morning. Or do we conceive it rather as the formation of a political will, something that is done in an open public discourse? Then it raises concerns, because it sounds rather like manipulating a singled out individual than convincing a person in an open public discussion. And if you think that's what politics is about, and election is part of this political system, then micro-targeting, well, is just threatening our idea of how we organize our democracy.
Julie, it comes to a deeper question. If those methods are used to promote perfumes or whatever, so if they are used to promote goods, can we forbid parties to use the methods of digital marketing? Debatable they are.
I agree with Jeanette on this one, 100%. I think we need to separate out micro-targeting from fake news and from unsubstantiated claims in the realm of goods and services. Politicians as well as companies have been using direct advertising tools, data brokers, for years and years and years. And as Jeanette said, in 2008 and 2012, these tools were lauded as a way to effectively spend dollars in the context of a campaign. In many ways, in the context of the political elections, I think the micro-targeting aspect of what happened in 2016 is of a piece with the disaggregation of media generally. I mean, we used to, those of us who are of a certain age, will remember that there were three television channels in the United States. I'm guessing in Germany there were about the same number. Everybody tuned in and watched Walter Cronkite, and he would tell us, not me, I was actually too young at the time, but he would say, you know, this is what's happening in the United States, and it was a view that, that people could aggregate around. Whether you agreed or disagreed is one is different. We now have complete disaggregation of media. People read what they want to read because they go where they want to go. Micro-targeting is very much a part of that. But it doesn't mean that micro-targeting is synonymous with fake news. Unfortunately, we have, how can I say this? People in the United States who have a very large platform who are not micro-targeting but speaking to the entire country and disseminating fake news. So these things are not necessarily related at all. So I think we do need to maintain, as I think Jeanette was saying, the important aspects of micro-targeting, the ability of people to reach their audience, the ability of people to get their message out, very important for free speech, very important for democracy, separate that from falsehoods. And unfortunately, in the political context in the United States, there's a whole different regime for assessing whether or not speech is allowed. In a commercial context, if you say something that isn't true, regulators will go after you. And indeed, interestingly enough, in my experience as a federal trade commissioner, I have found claims in the United States being prosecuted much more vigorously when it comes to things like, will a lotion make you skinnier? Will you be able to fit into your jeans and get rid of cellulite and all of that stuff? The Federal Trade Commission goes after companies that say that. I go to Paris and I see these ads all over the place and nobody's doing anything about it. So I think it is important to separate these concepts. I think we do need to think about when it's happening in a commercial context versus a political context. Mm-hmm. But I think we, as a society, should pull out, and I think this is very much what Jeanette was saying, pull out what's good about these efforts to reach particular audiences to make sure that they understand what's happening or not happening, and separate that out from the falsehoods that are being generated at whatever level of targeting, whether it's macro, as we're seeing in the United States now, or as granular as you can get.
Can I do just a quick follow-up?
Absolutely.
So I think the same way we think about privacy by design as like a path to go, we need to think about an ethics by design regarding micro-targeting and these tools that we're talking about. Because when you put, for instance, AI in the evolution of AI that is forthcoming together with these micro-targetings, and basically we become subjects of a permanent A-B testing regarding our preferences and so on, I find that a little bit unethical. And I would prefer that product designers would have a little bit of a long-term perspective regarding that and built in ethics concerns in the design of these services. And I think that would be a way to start.
But couldn't it be just a modern form of unethical campaigning? We have traditional forms of unethical campaigning that people, famous examples here in Germany of leading politicians said 20 years ago, your pensions are safe.
Right.
And everybody knew already at that time that our pensions are not safe and that we just have to save money if we want to survive when we get old. So that's basically an old form of unethical, and it wasn't forbidden either. Joel, what do you think?
Well, you framed it as these targeted services that politicians use to target particular voters. I think it's a deeper and broader problem than that. I think it's there's an ecosystem problem that, to me at least, is I think more dangerous for democracy. And that's the way we have a filter bubble world in our online systems. And I think the filter bubbles are probably more dangerous than propaganda targeting with fake news. So I'll give an example. Facebook conducted two experiments on its users, the emotional contagion experiment and the voting experiment. In the first one, they found they could manipulate people's emotions based on what the news feed showed for individual users. In the second one, they claim that, I think it was the 2010 election, by posting the I voted button on certain Facebook users' pages and not others, they could influence the probability that someone will vote. and they claimed that 340,000 more votes were cast because of the placement of that button. If that turns out to be right, Facebook can change an election. They can choose to display that I voted button only on certain voters in certain precincts because they know what our political opinions are based on our use of Facebook and algorithms. Google search, if Google search is only going to display for me because of their customization certain types of information, that's a filter bubble that will prevent my having the kind of extra information to evaluate whether a piece of data I get is fake or not.
Absolutely, very, very interesting topic. Of course, we have concentrated a lot of powers in the hand of very few people who are on top of those platforms. Just replace the name Mark Zuckerberg with the new CEO of Facebook, Steve Bannon. You will see a lot of different buttons emerging on Facebook. Are there any legal means that we can control a platform or force a platform, if it's so powerful, to be open to every opinion, to be to not foster filter bubbles, to whatever? Can we do that?
A democracy has a hard time doing that because there are basic freedom of speech rights that exist that protect the platform's activities as well as the user's activities.
Martin, could we force Facebook to change the algorithm that filter bubbles get not developed in a way they are developing now? Theoretically,
well, I'm
legally.
Not sure whether we would like to do that, because I think the problem of filter bubbles isn't that big as we imagine it to be. That's at least what people say that do a lot of research in communication stuff, and therefore it might go just far beyond. Maybe it's just better to enhance a plurality of opinions by fostering other channels of communication. Introducing other actors into these networks instead of forcing the network to change its algorithm. Therefore, I think there are alternative means that are more convincing than just making Facebook sort of an internally pluralized provider of information.
Well said.
I completely agree.
Yeah, I tend to agree as well. And I also think there can be industry solutions. For instance, some sort of self-regulation, hybrid regulation. I think all these are tools that I think might be useful for this debate.
Perfect.
You know, Louis Brandeis, who is the father of free speech, and also, interestingly, the father of the Federal Trade Commission, which is the chief privacy regulator in the United States, was very focused on the notion that the way to fight speech is more speech. In other words, if you don't like what people are saying, speak out. And I think that's why I said what you said was so well put, right? It's not that you should limit speech on Facebook, but rather have more people posting, have more people bringing out the fact that that the opinions that are in these filter bubbles are wrong. So I completely agree.
Jeanette?
But Julie, you pointed yourself out that our media system is in disarray at the moment.
Disaggregated, absolutely.
And if we take into account that a few platforms seem to also absorb independent media, as happens right now with Facebook, then your notion of more speech as a way of fighting speech becomes a problem, because if it's organized by a few companies that sort of structure the national but also the transnational public sphere, then the question is valid whether that few platforms that structure the public space become a means of sort of disproportionately influencing the public discourse.
It is true that platforms that have a lot of eyes on them are going to have the ability, if they so chose, to influence what you see and what you don't see. But my particular view of the way in which they're structured now, Facebook, for instance, is, you know, anyone can post, anyone can create, anyone can go create a business or have a media platform, whether or not they a lot of people see it will be a factor will be a factor of their content, right? As well as, you know, whether there's the synergistic effects of other people seeing it.
But you don't control the news feed, do you? You, as a user, don't know how your news feed is actually put together.
So when we looked at this at the Federal Trade Commission, I mean, consumers actually have a choice about what they're going to see, whether they're going to see the news feed that is filtered and curated by Facebook, or whether they will have an unadulterated feed. You can choose how you're...
Selection, whether you want it...
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
There's still going to be an algorithmic selection for the feed. Otherwise, there wouldn't be... you don't have the space for it. There's another aspect, though.
Well, no, it's...
challenge...
I don't think so. Sorry.
Twitter does. Twitter allows you to see it unfiltered, but Facebook does filter.
So let me pick up on the Twitter point. The Brandeis notion that more speech is the best response, we've seen in Twitter in this past election the role that bots played in drowning out speech. So, and we saw cases, and there were some interesting studies that were done on the number of bots belonging to the different political campaigns. And you could see this where a feed would start on a particular substantive topic, and then there would essentially be a bot attack that would drown out any legitimate discussion on that topic. So the notion that responding with more speech because of the technology could be completely squelched. And I think that's something we have to take seriously and worry about.
I do agree that there are technological issues that absolutely should be addressed, full stop. But I don't think the alternative is to have the government control these platforms. I would worry deeply in the current political context in the United States, in the current political context in Brazil, in the current political context in Russia or China, if we were to have platforms that were controlled by the government. I mean, one of the big issues that I have discussed many times in the United States when policies are being established, and I'll use one example, which is a little orthogonal, but I think it proves the point. When Dodd-Frank was being discussed in 2008, and this was a big law that was being enacted in the United States to deal with the Great Recession that we experienced back at that time, the Democrats set up a very important agency called the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which was designed to be a much more robust agency than some people thought the Federal Trade Commission could be in terms of dealing with debt and dealing with abuse of consumers in terms of mortgages and things like that. So there was a big conversation about how to create that organization, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and whether or not it should be modeled like the FTC, such that it would be a commission, a bipartisan commission of Republicans and Democrats, or a multi-party commission, or whether it should be led by one person, a director. And the very strong advocates within the Democratic Party who really wanted to see this agency set up said, no, we want one director, because we think it will be more effective with one director. And I would say to them, that's great right now when you have one particular party in power, but what's going to happen in 8 years when the likelihood is that that will switch? And do you really want to see a Consumer Financial Protection Bureau that is led by with someone with a very, very different view on this agency? And they said, well, yeah, well, that's 8 years down the road. We're not worried about that right now. Fast forward 8 years, and we may see the decimation of this agency now. So this is a long way of saying, and it's just to prove the point, that when we're setting up structures of how to deal with whether it's free speech and platforms or whether it's a Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, you need to be thinking about not only today and who's in power and whether there are people that agree with you or not, but you need to be thinking about future political systems that could be very, very different.
Jeanette, you wanted to add one?
I wanted to add from the German perspective that one of the lessons we learned is that media regulation absolutely has to take place independent of government. And when we think of how to deal with the concentration of power of some of the platforms we see right now, we also need to think about the power or the authority we would generate by trying to regulate these platforms. So it has to be in a way where we don't sort of create a monster that we try to prevent.
Exactly. Talking about German experiences or European experiences, we have this great invention of public broadcasting, which is very successful in Europe. And we are talking about how, well, you might not like it that much, Matthias, I'm sure, but it has great acceptance, and we are talking about to what extent it should be present in the digital world. And so we have alternative channels that are independent from government as well as from market forces, and not everybody likes them as much as I do.
No, I'm smiling a little bit because as independent as you describe them, they are not. We know that we all have example of state interference into these decision pools and so on. I would like to jump, before we open the panel to the audience, I would like to jump to one other point. We talked now about the private sector, but what we see is a huge increase of amassing of data, and a huge increase of data, of personal data in the hand of governments. Mm-hmm. And specifically in the US, we see projects where databases from all different agencies get combined to filter out illegal immigrants, but it can also be used for all other things. Joel, I would like to ask you, I mean, of course this is done in the private world, can we interfere when the state, or do we have to interfere when the state does the same what Facebook or an online marketing company does?
Well, I think in the public sector, the state has a very strong coercive power, and we have to be sure that we are effectively able to have oversight on the state's activities. And I think in many ways that's, at least in the United States, where we have some serious problems and issues to resolve. I think there's certainly instances where if there is an important public interest and there is effective accountability for the state apparatus, it would be very anomalous to prohibit the state from accessing data that's available in the commercial marketplace. So if we know, for example, that certain kinds of data will be helpful for law enforcement, and we have effective oversight of the law enforcement, and the data is available in the marketplace, it's hard to say we should cripple the state from getting access to it.
Amassing data is one thing, but when you combine that with artificial intelligence, when you put predictive analysis on it, and then you try to figure out who of the audience here will become a criminal within the next 5 years.
So here's a key problem that we have in our legal system for that. Those systems presume everyone is guilty because it's amassing, it's mining to find who that guilty person is. To be able to take mine me to determine whether or not I'm guilty, it's kind of a reversal of our presumption of innocence. I don't think we yet have a good oversight mechanism for the state's monitoring activities. When you bring all these databases together and you give the state the capacity to effectively monitor citizens on a 24/7 basis, that is a major issue that we currently, I don't think, have been able to grapple with appropriately. I'll just throw in one more. Our Fourth Amendment right in the United States, which is the right that requires the state to get a warrant, we have a doctrine that says if the information is publicly available, individuals have no reasonable expectation of privacy, and therefore the state can get it and do what it wants with it. Our Supreme Court has made some noises in a recent case that maybe we should be rethinking that, but that's where we are today.
Okay, so I think first point to establish is data is important for public administration. So there is the famous Michael Bloomberg sentence in which he says, if you cannot manage it, You cannot, if you cannot measure it, you cannot manage it. And I think that's right. So especially for countries like Brazil, it's important to have the necessary data to improve public services. But with that said, I think there is a concern here about data collection on the part of the state. And one of the reasons for that is that a lot of the data that is collected is not voluntary. So like it or not, on Facebook, at least I have like the terms of use, and if I don't want to share my data, I can at least not use those services. So I have somehow that option. Right. While, for instance, a recent case in the city of São Paulo in Brazil, the new mayor announced that it's going to sell the database of the public system users. So basically the database that records electronically what every user, where the person took the bus, where he was dropped off, how much he paid, how many times he does that a day. And basically he was saying, I'm going to sell this because it's very valuable. The problem is, if I do not agree to have my data collected by the city of São Paulo city transit system, I have to move from São Paulo, maybe to Rio de Janeiro, maybe to Berlin, because I do not have the option not to have my data collected. So that sort of data that is mandatory, it has to at least follow a finality principle. You have to know that that data is going to be used for certain public services, but not be accessible to the police or to private companies or whatever. Yeah. And I think that is very important, and it's a missing link regarding the discussion of data protection.
I think we all agree, not only in the industry is running ahead, and the regulation is coming too late in some, or not fast enough, also in the state sector. I would like to open the podium and the audience for questions. We have microphones. One is over there and one is over there, and I would ask the people who ask questions, please go to the mics and address the questions to us. Yeah. And perhaps you introduce you with
My name is Peter Schaar. I'm of the data protection community. Well, I want to ask the panelists, why do we deal with the right of reply? This is an instrument we know from the media. It is a very eminent instrument. Newspapers are obliged to publish replies of persons who are concerned by publications in the same way as the articles. Why shouldn't we use these instruments in the new media world more than we do it today? Of course, you can answer to a tweet, of course. But shouldn't there be a right of linkage of the reply to the original tweet or to the original message? That could be an obligation for the platform provided, as it is today for the media, to publish these replies in an appropriate way.
Who would like to jump on that?
I would just caution against such a proposal, because it goes, of course, both ways. You might publish something and somebody will claim the right to link his or her comments on what you said, and that might be just as abusive as that what you try to fight.
Next question, please.
So I want to go back to the German bill for fining social media and intermediaries for failing to remove illegal content. And I think that to some extent it was assumed in the panel that the notice and takedown might be useful. And I would suggest that to look at some of the empirical data that we already have in the United States on notice and takedown that has become, in fact, a cleanup system for the internet. So on the one hand, you have zero accountability That is the only way in the United States for removing content that is, you know, for defamatory reasons, for right to be forgotten, that is not, that there is no right like this in the United States. But the notice of takedown system has been used to remove this particular content. In some of the empirical studies show that more than 50% of these notices are just defamatory issues, inciting materials, privacy concerns. And so you have a system, zero accountability, the counter notice is almost never being used. It created a system of private law. Content ID is actually a private copyright law. What is catched by the content ID is considered copyright infringement, regardless of whether it is in fact copyright infringement. And I agree that with Jeanette that we need to manage the content algorithmically. So the question is whether we can have accountability coming from the state in setting standards for the algorithms on what it is to be removed or not, or allowing the public to tinker the system and understand more precisely what it is that is being removed, like shifting to different ways of accountability rather than shifting the burden on the social intermediaries.
Who would like to answer that?
Well, go right ahead.
I think notice and takedown, of course, is the model and after which all these other systems are modeled. I think it's difficult to find the specifications, and I think it's much easier just to monitor first what is happening, and that's why I'm asking for publication of the decisions and the statement of grounds, so that we get an idea about what the appropriate criteria would be like, because just from the scratch board, designing criteria for inappropriate illegal content is very difficult. And therefore, I think that would be the final goal. But as a first step, the interplay between published decisions by the private enterprises and court decisions and the public discourse would be much better. I don't know whether this answers your question.
Yes, Richard Allen at Facebook, and I'm glad I came today. I just wanted to kind of put one piece of fact in there and then go on to talk about hate speech. Just on the factual point, on newsfeed, Julie Brill is right. If any of you want to, you can switch your newsfeed to show most recent first. Most recent is a purely chronological newsfeed. Right, most people prefer the algorithmically ordered newsfeed. If you take that, you still have every story in there for every person you're connected to. It's just that the important ones that we've decided are important based on the algorithm go at the top. So, point of fact on that.
Could I just ask a factual clarification?
Yeah.
What's the that you said it's the most, if you opt for the non-filtered news feed, you get the most recent. What's the selection of news sources for that most recent feed?
The connections you've made. So, the news feed consists of every page, every person, every object on Facebook, every group.
So it's still being filtered for the individual.
But you have chosen the filter. You have chosen the filter.
Yeah, yeah. We're not putting stuff in the newsfeed. You are putting your own stuff in your newsfeed. So, newsfeed. Hate speech. That's the bit I really want to focus on. I think there is a sort of underlying assumption that it is obvious what illegal hate speech is. I look at this stuff every day. Most of what we're talking about is a newspaper article saying some group of people committed a crime, for example, and underneath there is a comment that says, these people are scum. And then you have to parse out by these people, do they mean the people who committed the crime? Do they mean generically the ethnic group those people belong to, etc.? So there's a lot of that kind of content that floats around on the platform. The other areas that we see, attitudes change over time. So the recent argument between the Netherlands and Turkey, suddenly you get an upswelling of people using pretty offensive terms on both sides about each other. Now, the way that this, I think, needs to play out is that courts, when they look at this kind of speech, they don't just say, was the speech offensive? Did they use a slur? They say, let's weigh that against the free speech interest of that political debate. And what we find as we go out and try and get advice on this, because we want to comply with the law, is that we get multiple different versions of advice from different people, and there just isn't the case law. So my proposal as a fix, I'd be very interested in Marty's view in particular and others on this, is like what we really need is several hundred judgments from judges weighing up speech value against hate speech, and then giving us a framework we can work to. I understand the Brazilian system, the Marco Civil, is much closer to this.
Yeah.
Where there is people are driven to court to get a court judgment.
That's exactly right.
And service providers, well, and that's fantastic. But it seems it's only Brazil that's doing that, and everybody else has a court system where the cases don't get to court. Or if they do, it's like 4 or 5 years before you get some kind of judgment that's useful to you. So I think something that's more Marco Seville-like would really help us.
Can I ask one factual question? When you say you see the most recent one, does that mean it's unfiltered or not unfiltered? Is it completely unfiltered?
So let's just, to be very precise, unfiltered. Most recent is every page and person you've connected to, when they publish a story, we will show those to you chronologically. We won't show you stuff that you haven't connected to. The newsfeed is the aggregation of every page, group, person that you have connected to on Facebook. To that extent, it's filtered by you.
Ronaldo, you would like to explain how it works in Brazil?
Right, so very quickly, because I see we have a line there.
Right.
Basically, the Brazilian system is the platform is liable when it receives a court order ordering the content to be taken down. The exception to that is copyright infringement, which goes to a system very similar to the United States. So what that allows is that there is a body of jurisprudence, of court decisions, that basically tells you what are the criteria in order to abide regarding what's legal and illegal. So that's how the Brazilian system works.
Next question, please.
Hello, my name is Martin Oetting. I'm a political blogger, and I just have one sort of comment to make about this notion that more speech of sort of the other kind will counter speech of the one kind. And I think we have to bear in mind that there's different qualities of speech, particularly when somebody is fear-mongering and basically appealing to the lower instincts of humans, that can often be just psychologically, for any given audience, more powerful than a person who says, well, it's not quite so, or, you know, things need to be seen in a more moderate way. So I think just to say somebody is, you know, expressing thoughts of a certain nature, and if that nature is not to our liking, we can fight it by expressing thoughts that go in the other direction, just in terms of its impact, will probably not be effective in any case, and particularly not in the cases that we deem the most dangerous ones. Thank you.
So can I just, since I was the one who brought up that point, I'll just respond that I understand what you're saying, and I agree that there are some very tough situations that we've dealt with over the past cycle, shall we say. The reason I brought up that notion, which is a very old notion, and comes from someone who cared very deeply about speech, is I'm thinking about what is the alternative. Right? It's kind of like we often hear said that democracy is the worst system in the world except for all others. Right? I mean, if you are going to try to design a government-run program for directing what kind of speech will be allowed or how it will be structured or who gets to speak when, all I'm urging you to do is to think about the alternate facts that you will face. I hate using that term. Let me come up with a different one. The scenario that you will inevitably face, they're not alternate facts, they will be true facts, that you will inevitably face 4 years down the road, 8 years down the road, or maybe even tomorrow. And you need to future-proof whatever system you take or create so that it works when you agree with who's in power, and it will work when you violently disagree with who's in power. That's the concern I have about taking any other approach. I'm not, but it's troubling. I'm not. I totally agree with what you're saying. I just don't have a good answer, and I've thought about this a lot, as have all of us, what the right alternative is, given the inevitability that others will be coming to power.
There's Vinsurf having a question.
So you notice I cleverly arranged to shift venue to take advantage of the fact that there was no line over here. This is called microphone shopping. I have an almost orthogonal and maybe bizarre point to make. I listened to all of the struggles about online content and its removal or censorship or, you know, speech being generated to counter the bad speech. And I have this because we can feeling about this discussion. And what I mean by this is it's because we can do some of these things in the online world, we have these debates and we try to do them. If we were talking about other media, and we were trying to do what you're describing, we would be ripping books and newspapers out of libraries and breaking into people's homes and ripping things off of their bookshelves. And we all see how ludicrous that would be. I'm not arguing that our discussion is silly and stupid and wasteful and so on. I am just struck by the irony of the different media and the rules that we are attempting to induce because we can. And I worry about that.
Actually, I like this notion very much, this because we can, but I would also apply it to collecting personal data. Because it's so cheap, because we can, we think we can use it as a universal remedy for all insecurities we have produced ourselves. So I think that notion has a much broader scope than the one you just mentioned.
I was also sort of struck by those comments, because when you think of media regulation in the United States, we actually historically have treated different forms of media differently. The way we regulate print media versus broadcast media versus cable have three different sets of rules, from must carry to no, you can't touch us, there is no right of reply. So we've had variations. As the technologies have evolved, we've seen the law change to match what were perceived problems with these new forms of media. And I think we're in the same era right now. A difference today is the internet facilitates a velocity of the circulation of information that we didn't have before. And it enables, as your talk this morning so graphically demonstrated, the ability of the one-to-many communications that didn't exist before. So that poses new challenges.
The next question, please.
Hi, Adam Knight from University of Oxford. So far, we've heard a lot about the US and Europe, and I guess I wanted to return more to the topic of the panel, which is the world. And so I was intrigued by Ronaldo's comment about Brazilian politicians following or closely watching what's going on in Germany, mm-hmm. and perhaps taking that back and readapting it to kind of local circumstances. And my question really revolves around kind of alternate models to internet governance. So the one that really springs to mind would be China and their notion of internet sovereignty. And my question really is, how do we, or Europe, America, engage with countries that are actively looking for models of internet governance? How do we engage them to avoid them perhaps falling down a path that would follow the example of countries such as China?
I'd like to take that.
Okay, you can also ask easy questions, right? But so this is a hard one, and I have only two things to consider. So the first thing to consider is how internet regulation came about in Brazil. And that was through a multi-stakeholder open platform process, in which everyone had to put their cards on the table, including the telcos, the platforms, the federal police, civil society. That created a lot of transparency, and that created a lot of cross cooperation, and of course a lot of conflict as well. And the outcome was positive. So that, at least for me, it taught me a lesson. Democracy works. It gives you a lot of work. It's like a very tiresome. You have to be resilient. You have to insist. But if you put those processes together, which are basically the long run, in the end, you have a better outcome. and they work. So that's why I think the Brazilian Internet Bill of Rights is actually seen as a sort of a model law for a lot of other countries in how to approach internet regulation, both in terms of process and in terms of the outcome. So that's my small individual lesson that I have to share about a very hard question.
And I think we are all very sympathetic with that, but I would bet that a guest from China or a panelist from Russia, at least when he is more closer to the government side, would see it a little differently.
But I do think the Chinese government cares deeply about the way the rest of the world thinks about it and the way the rest of the world is viewing its actions. And I have found in the last 7 to 8 years that engagement is very important. Engagement at all levels, but especially engagement with government officials. It doesn't mean that you're going to change their mind. And I think data localization and the new Chinese cybersecurity law are kind of two examples there, where there are definitely some troubling trends. But when it comes to things like competition enforcement, when it comes to consumer protection enforcement, there are definitely ways to engage and try to explain why going down certain paths could actually be more harmful than going down other paths in the long run. Again, it is a very, very tough question. I don't think there is a solution. I'm really glad it was asked because I do think it's important to think about the rest of the world. But I think engagement is probably the best. You know, building bridges, not building walls, is the best way to go.
Absolutely. Thank you. Next question, please.
Bernard Klemm from the European University Institute. I try to ask another hard question. So we've talked a lot about the risk of the government unduly regulating platforms in terms of free speech. I'm wondering about the risk of platforms themselves regulating or restricting free speech in an unduly or biased way. I mean, although Facebook at the moment is very hesitant to restrict free speech in any way or judge about limits of free speech in any way, we can think of cases where at least seems to be the risk of bias, like the episode where Facebook allegedly biased the composition of its trending topics about a year ago, where allegedly liberal sources were preferred over conservative news articles. And so my question is about the imaginary situation that these platforms kind of start to limit free speech in a biased way. Would it then be, in your view, legally be permissible to rein in as the public, as a government, to ensure that on these platforms free speech can happen? Important. And so the second related question is, how big does a platform have to be for that to be legitimate?
Thank you. It's an important question, Joel.
Yeah, I think I'll take this first from a US perspective. The First Amendment protects the platform in its choice of what it will display to its users. I think it would be extremely difficult in American law to be able to regulate the platform. It might be possible to require a greater degree of transparency for the algorithmic process that's resulting in the selection, but I think that's going to be a very challenging one. The free expression rights outside the United States are have more exceptions to them, I think, than we have in the U.S. But I think even there, for the kind of concern that you have, the censorship by platform, I think, at least following some of the Strasbourg court decisions in Europe, it would be very difficult to do that.
So I actually disagree. I think under U.S. law, there would be a very potent way to deal with that issue in the event that you have a platform that says, we're going to be presenting unbiased views, or we will provide you with a news feed that is chronological, or whatever, right? And then they don't. There would be a very powerful case that could be brought under either the Federal Trade Commission Act for deceptive or unfair practices, or under the state attorney general's laws, which basically provide for the same thing.
But then the platform just doesn't.
So what it would require would be a platform that makes certain representations about what kinds of services it provides. And if you have a platform that cares about the way people think about it, you know, typically speaking, whether it's in the terms of service or in the privacy policy or in just a broad explanation to consumers about what is provided to them, you will see those kind of representations. So I'm not saying that that is as the same type of regulation that might take place in Europe, but it has been a very powerful tool that has been used by privacy and cybersecurity enforcement regulators in the United States with respect to the very biggest platforms that exist.
Some people who think we need to update our antitrust laws, our national antitrust laws, that are not able to deal with the sort of power concentration and the potential abuse of that power right now. And another proposal I've heard about is that terms of services, they are at the moment just set by the platform providers. Perhaps we want our consumer agencies to have a word in there to protect the users of these platforms, because there is not really an equality of powers between platform providers and their customers.
You could also use the terms of services, because under European law they have to take into consideration the fundamental rights, and so they have to consider free speech aspects.
So I think the notion of using the terms of service,
if they are a dominant player, of course,
as a way of regulating this, well, from the American side, Julie, I'll disagree with you. I think it would be a completely ineffective way of dealing with it, because the terms of service would be unlikely to make those assertions, or if they were to make assertions, they would be made in such a vague way, which we see in the privacy policy context, that it would be very, very difficult to bring a deceptive practice claim against them. In terms of regulating the content of the terms of service, I think they're, at least in the U.S. context, would be very, very difficult to do.
I think it's really important. I'm sorry. We're in Europe. I think Europeans really need to know that we have, in the United States, very effective privacy enforcement. It's a meme that gets played over and over in Europe, and I spent 6 years traveling through Berlin, traveling through Paris, through Brussels and London to try to explain. It's a complex system, but it is very effective, and there are lots of companies that spend all of their time. What do they worry about? They worry about the FTC, and they worry about European DPAs, and that's what they're thinking about 100% of the time.
Okay.
We cannot have a conversation that makes it seem as if the US does not have privacy enforcement. That is just not true.
I told you we have a very passionate panel, and I think we just started a new debate, but unfortunately I have to watch the time, and we had one more question.
Walked
away.
It's a long 2 days. So being here, we have time.
The good thing is you can continue the debate. It will continue. It will not be done after this forum. So thank you very much, and thank you very much to my panelists.
So thank you.